Hallelujah.
Just to see you.
To behold.
To behold you as my King.
Hold the music, hold the singing. I want to just hear the saints just worship. Come on. If there's a true worship in the house, just give him some true worship. Just give him some true worship. Somebody said, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem. And we crown him. Can somebody crown him? Come on, just forget about your neighbor. Forget about what's behind you, in front of you. And just begin to give some true worship. Oh, God. If you need to close your eyes, whatever you need to do, just forget about everything and begin to give God some true worship. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, Lord. For your glory, Lord. Come on, worshipers, don't stop worshiping. Keep worshiping, keep worshiping. God, there's a spirit of breakthrough in this house. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Just keep worshiping. God is in the midst. When the praises go up, it was Jesus who said, if I be lifted up from this earth, then I will draw all men. So saints, when we begin to lift him up, then God begins to do the drawing. Somebody lift him up. Somebody lift him up. Somebody lift him up. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Hallelujah. Go ahead and just worship. Go ahead and continue to worship. Go ahead. This is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And we allow God to have his way in this house. Oh, we allow God to have his way in this house. At any time he chooses, any time he pleases, sir. Ah, God. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, worshipers, continue worshiping. Don't spectate what God is doing. Let's continue to worship. Let's continue to worship. Let's continue to worship. Let's continue to worship. Go ahead and worship. Go ahead and glorify him. Go ahead and continue to magnify him. We just said, for your glory, Lord, we will do anything. Go ahead and magnify him. Hallelujah! master. It's not by might nor is it by power, but it's by my spirit, said the Lord. We stand knowing that whatever we ask in Jesus' name, believing it shall be granted. And we say, woman, thou art loose. We speak over your entire being. We speak over your body. We speak over your soul and spirit. We say, woman, thou art loose. In Jesus' name. Come on, somebody magnify him. Come on, somebody magnify him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. 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 If you need to still worship saints, go ahead. Oh God, you ain't got no chains on you. You ain't got no shackles on you. If you still need to shout a hallelujah, if you still need to lift your hands, go ahead. You ain't got no chains on you in here. This is the pillar and the ground of truth. And every devil, every demon that come in this building have to be subjected to the power that comes from on high. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God bless you, musicians. There is a spiritual warfare that has been going on. This warfare has been happening long before you and I came on this earth. But we are also thankful to God that we know whose side we're on. And having this confidence that we're on the Lord's side, the church has no need to be fearful. The church has no need to be worried. Because we know that victory is ours in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Amen. Somebody say amen. Amen. Come on, open your mouth, open your mouth. Your victory is in your mouth. Praise God. Ezekiel, the Lord asked him the question, can these dry bones live? He said, Lord, thou knowest. The Lord said to him, prophesy. In other words, open your mouth and speak life. Can somebody open their mouth today and give God glory? Hallelujah. The reason why the devil sits on so much of our backs and the devil, praise God, have us burdened down and have us worried and have us all sorts of weird is because we refuse to speak over our life. But can somebody declare today that God is God, and it's God I serve, and I stand on the side of victory. Can somebody speak life to thee? Glory, glory, glory. You may be seated if you can. Hallelujah. I greet the Spirit of God, and let me just say that there's just something about being in the presence of the Lord. I guarantee you everybody here today have some issues or some problems that they have faced or is going through. But there's just something about being in the house of God, being among the saints. You see, when we look at the kingdom of hell, and we look at the kingdom of God, and look at the mathematical equation, we realize that what the devil does, the devil divides and he subtracts. But God adds and multiply. Somebody say amen. And so it was the psalmist that said, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. The psalmist went further and said, I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord. Praise God. I listen to the testimonies of the saints, and I must say that my soul has been rich and blessed just by listening to the many testimonies, just by listening to what the saints have to say. I declare today, praise God, as we know who we are, that Sister Jennifer shall go down in water in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody, I need somebody to agree with me. The church has got to come with me. I declare that Sister Shireen shall go down in water. In water baptism in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Somebody say amen. Praise God. I declare victory in the church. Oh God, the church should be, somebody should be giving God some glory up in this house. Praise God. Earlier in the week, the Lord spoke to my spirit and gave me a word. I must say that the direction that I thought that I would be going in this morning, the Lord gave me a word that was completely different from what I had in mind. I must truly say, as a preacher, as a leader, I had something in my mind that I wanted to speak, but I always leave my spirit open to God to make sure that when God speaks, praise God, we don't bring our word to speak to his people, but we bring the word of the Lord. Amen, somebody. Praise God. And I always ask God that, Lord, depending on what you want me to speak, you got to give me a confirmation. And I must tell you that it was with the Sunday school lesson when I realized what the lesson was about. I did not read the lesson. Praise God. God spoke to my spirit before. And when I actually looked at the lesson, I believe it was yesterday when we post the Sunday school lesson in the group, Sister Tamisha said, I'm not sure if I'm quoting her properly, but she said that this is a powerful lesson or something to that effect. And when I look at the lesson, I realize what the Lord was actually saying. So I'm going to ask you to turn to two passages of scripture. Praise God. And we're going to look in the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter number 30. Praise God, and we're going to be reading verse 6 through 8 in 1 Samuel chapter 30, 6 through 8, and then we're going to also go down to the book of Jeremiah, yes, the book of Jeremiah chapter 20, and reading verse 19. Just to show reverence to the word, I ask you to stand and show reverence to the word. Praise God. Jeremiah chapter number 30, reading from verse 6 to 8. And I ask you to not only just read, but as the psalmist says, Selah, means that you should observe what you're reading. So I want you to Selah the verses today as we are going to be reading and observing carefully what the word is saying. Samuel 30. Verse 6 to 8. And the Bible says, and David was greatly distressed. Somebody say greatly distressed. For the people, speaking of his own men, spake of stoning him because the soul of all the people was grieved. Every man for his son and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord. And David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me the ephod. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David. And David watches. Inquired at the Lord, saying, Shall I pursue after this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered him, pursue, for thou shalt surely overtake them, and without fail recover all. Jeremiah 20 verse 9 says, then I said, I will not make mention of him. This is Jeremiah speaking of God, because Jeremiah was now in prison at this time. He was, praise God, a prophet, and he prophesied. He did God's will, but found himself in prison. So Jeremiah got a bit caught up in himself, and he said, then I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. Oh God, but his word. Oh God, hallelujah. His word. Somebody say his word. Hallelujah. Is there anybody feeling the fire today? But his word was in my heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones. And I was weary with forbearing and could not stay. Father, have your way. Speak to your great people. Open their hearts now. In Jesus' name. As you're taking your seat, just turn to somebody and say, encourage yourself. Oh God. The irony is you're encouraging them, but the truth is, you need to encourage yourself. Come on, find somebody else and say, encourage yourself. Come on, man. Tell somebody, encourage yourself. Encourage yourself. Yes, yes, yes. Praise God. I ask you to pray for me today as I, praise God, time is really far spent, but I believe that the Lord wants to speak to somebody. Praise God. I believe that the Lord has a word for somebody. Praise God. In our walk with God, we have to understand that if we don't know God, if we don't understand God, then we cannot reach where we are to go in Him. Praise God. In order to reach our destination, we have got to not only just know about God, but we have got to know Him for ourselves. Somebody say amen. And so I spoke already and told you that when Moses was being raised in the house of Pharaoh, his mother was there with him, and Moses' mother continued to tell Moses about the God of the Israelites, and that he was the one who spoke to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Even though Moses was knowing and learning about the gods of the Egyptians, but he remembered what his mother told him. But I want to get you to understand something, that though Moses knew about God from his mother, it did not really mean that Moses knew God. Are you with me? Praise God. There's a difference with knowing about God and knowing God, because Moses knew God only on the premise of which his mother said. Yes, because there are some folks in church, as I said before, that they can quote scriptures based on what Paul said or what Peter said or what the Psalm said, but you find that when it comes to standing up for themselves, when issues come, God, it's another story. They run and they hide. Am I talking to somebody? Praise God. And so we understand that while Moses knew about God, it was not until about 40 years later when he met God at the burning bush that he got an understanding of who God was. You see, walking with God means that we are not only going to know about Him, but walking with God means that we are going to know Him. It was Jesus who asked the question, whom do men say that I am? And they told Him what people had to say. But then it comes a point in time when we have to move from what somebody else said and get to know God for ourselves. How many in here can talk about somebody who said that they fasted 3 days and they prayed 3 nights? How many here have heard somebody who testified about the fact that they were in the spirit and God showed them a vision? We've heard these many things, but how many of us can speak for ourselves that I was also praying and I got caught up in the spirit? How many can speak for ourselves and say that I once was sick and I laid my hands on my own body and spoke healing? You see, it's different when we hear somebody talk about it and we stand on that. But then we have got to learn that we've got to know God for ourselves. Somebody say amen. I really don't want to push it too quick. Let me just take my time. You see, what we need to understand in our minds also, that as the people of God, the children of God, those who are getting ready to serve God, you need to hear this. You see, there are three aspects in Jesus's life that when we observe these three aspects of Jesus's life, all of us who are Christians, who are the children of God, we are all going to have to face the very same three things that Jesus faced. You see, in Jesus's life, there was a period of obscurity, meaning there was a time in Jesus' life when nobody knew Him. He was just a carpenter boy. Am I talking to somebody? And so nobody recognized that He was the Son of God. Nobody knew Him because His fame had not gone forth. But there came a time, which is the second aspect in Jesus' life, where it is the period of popularity. And this was the period when Jesus, He did the miracle at the wedding, and so people started to know about Jesus. It came to the point that wherever Jesus would go, that people would even take ships and follow Him. It came to the point that a woman left her own country and found Jesus hiding in a house. Am I talking to somebody? Because Jesus's fame, it had reached a peak. It came to a point as Jesus was entering the city of Jerusalem on a donkey back, that the people took their garments off and they broke the palm leaves down and they said, "Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord." In other words, wherever Jesus went, somebody was praising Him. Somebody was bigging Him up. Somebody was lifting Him up. Oh God, but also there's a third aspect in Jesus' life that we need to be conscious of, because after the popularity, there came the period of rejection. Am I talking to somebody? This is the period in Jesus' life when the very mouths that said, "Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord," were now shouting, "Crucify." Am I talking to somebody? So when you look at your life in church, you might be operating in your period of obscurity, when nobody knows that you can sing, nobody knows that you can preach, nobody knows the gifts that are in you. Am I talking to somebody? But there comes a time when God removes the veil from around you and God unleashes you. And somebody said, "Well, we've heard people sing, sing, but you can sing, because we've never heard anybody done it like that. Am I talking to somebody? They said we've heard people preach, but we've never heard anybody preach it with such authority. And so sometimes, wherever you go, somebody is there to pick you up. Somebody's there to give you a compliment. Somebody's there who's always texting and always encouraging you. But you need to understand that along with the period of popularity, when you find yourself in the position where you're getting everything your way, there's a period of rejection. Am I talking to somebody? When you find that your very choristers who used to be with you singing on the choir, you now become the main topic on the choir. Am I talking to somebody? Your very co-worker who you work so close with and talk so good with, you find now that very same one has turned their backs on you. Am I talking to somebody? You see, the thing about us as human beings, we have a tendency to depend on people. Am I talking to somebody? You see, in the Garden of Eden, when God made man, he said this, that it was not good for man to be alone. You see, that can't be changed, because God made us to fellowship. God made us to communicate with somebody. It not only meant that it was not good some man should get married, but it means that we have a tendency to communicate. We always need somebody. We always need somebody to talk to. Have you ever met somebody who's just miserable, who's just terrible, who's just awful, to the point where you can't stand them, but yet that person is married? Am I talking to somebody? So it means that even they need somebody to communicate with. Am I talking to the church? And so now it is in us to always need somebody. But you see, God is breaking us, or getting us to a point to understand this, that there is a point in your life where you can't depend on your brother or your sister. You see, what God wants us to understand, that even when your brother encourages you, the encouragement is not coming from them. Even when your sister blesses you, oh God, that blessing is not coming from your sister. You see, God is getting us to a point where our dependency doesn't come by man, because when we depend on man, if we don't see our brother, then we say to ourselves, then I'm dead now, because I don't see the person who can help me. Am I talking to somebody? Have you ever been to a place in your mind where you've been discouraged, and you have a brother or a sister or a good friend where you can always call? You can always expect to get a word from the person, but then you call the person and you get busy signal. Am I talking to somebody? So when that happens, you feel as if the world is over. But God is trying to get you to the point where your dependency is completely on him. Am I talking to somebody? You see, God is a jealous God. He says, my glory will I not give to another, nor my prayers to graven images. You see, when God brought Israel out of Egypt, they look at it and say, then let us build a calf, and say that this is who brought us out. When Moses came down, God tell Moses, kill some of them and dust out that image and let them drink it. Am I talking to somebody? You see, God jealous. You see, oh God, can I talk to some jealous men in the house? Is there any jealous husbands? Are you as a man, you know, say jealous? I'm not talking to you, my brother. You good. Oh God, can I talk to somebody? But when you're jealous, you don't want nobody else to look for your person, because are you one want get the good name? Are you one want look good to them? Am I talking to somebody? So when he come to God, he wants to get you to that place where you stop depending on mommy, you stop depending on daddy. I heard David said that when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. I heard David said, some trust in horses, some trust in chariots, but we will remember the name of the Lord, for the name of the Lord is a strong and mighty tower. The righteous run in and are saved. You see, God wants you to get you to that place where you depend completely on him. Oh God, we realize that the story that we look on today, David has been running for years. David had been running from Saul. David had had situations where he killed giants. So David had had many victories, but he had also had many defeats. Is there anybody who's ever been through some real hardship? Some really tough things? And you said, God, me just need a little peace. Praise God. I just need some ease. Am I talking to somebody? Praise God. But you got to understand this, that anybody who has purpose, praise God, your life will never be easy. Am I talking to somebody? Praise God. It was Peter who said, they that will live godly in this world, they must suffer persecution. So somebody may be wondering, why is it when I was going to when I was going to some fest, why is it when I was going to Sting and all these sort of different dances, and why is it when I was living a life of fornication, drinking and smoking, why is it that everything was going on just the way I wanted? But then as soon as me say somebody named Jesus, and as soon as I say I want to check out the man there, as soon as I start to visit him house, Lord God, is like all hell break loose. God, somebody is trying to wonder why. But let me let you understand this, that the devil doesn't know you when you're living for him. I saw the devil treating people, you know, he doesn't recognize them because he's already got you. I've said it before and I say it again, it's like a man have a good woman who take care of him, but yet him want what the outside. Am I talking to somebody? Oh God, him have the good woman who wash him, cook for him, and give him all sorts and nice food to eat, home cooked meal. But him look on somebody outside who dress a particular way, then can't even boil an egg good. Am I talk to somebody? Oh God, you see now, we have got to understand this, that when we look at this situation, the devil doesn't know you because he has you. But the minutes you decide that you want to go for God, the minute you decide that you want to serve God, watch this, because the devil knows it, from Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, you did a dance. Anyway, things they are gone, you did it. And so when the devil check your record, I realize how faithful you were in sin, and the devil assess it and say, no man, but if this one so faithful to me in a sin, if him get saved, then no terror him go be to me. Oh God, so when you realize that problem start happen, is because the devil get afraid of who you be. Am I talking to somebody? So when you see the problem them start coming in your life, not get discouraged, man. Oh God, stop. Decide, say, you know, but I won't go the Lord's way, because it means that the devil is getting afraid, the devil is getting scared, because him see power is in you, purpose is in you. The devil recognize that there's something on the inside. Somebody open the mouth and give him glory. David was at a place in his life where, no, David was anointed to be king of Israel. But it has been a number of years past. Still, David did not get to sit on the throne. So it seems now that the promise is something that is past. There are many of you in here who God has spoken to your spirit, but then time is what tests faith. Am I talking to the church? Because impatience is how we obtain the promise. But if we are not patient, then we are going to miss what God is doing, because David was anointed as king. But the irony is, he did not get to sit on the throne. So now, we have a tendency, as human, to settle. Am I talking to the church? Yes, yes, we have a tendency. Praise God, when we want something and we don't see going the way that we want it, praise God, then we settle for what we get. Am I talking to somebody? Yes, you have some great desire. God, praise God, if you are here and you intend to go to college, you intend to further your education, praise God, you don't see the money coming through for college, you don't see things going the way you want it, so you just settle in the job that you're in and tell yourself that this is who I'm going to be for the rest of my life, because you cannot see beyond where you actually are. So we have a tendency to just settle. God, you're probably with a certain man, and you know, so that man, praise God, means you no good. And some women too, praise God, you know that they don't intend to have a true future with you. Some of you get some kick and some box. Am I talking to somebody? But then you just settle, because praise God, you can't bother to go move again and go get somebody else. So you say, you know what, the kick and the box, what those mean is that I love you. So every kick you get, it means I love you. Every box you get, you see, I love you, because your brain starts twist and make you start make up excuse for you to feel comfortable in a way. In, am I talking to somebody? And saw some woman say, listen, let me tell you this, you, I saw a man beating a woman the other day, and when the man was beating the woman, I saw big muscled, muscular trapped in man went to the woman's rescue to mess the man up for the woman. And would you believe it, I said, that woman jumped in front of the man. I said, don't touch him, me need ask you for your help, I feel with business this, go on where you go. Am I talking to somebody? Because some women only know to settle. So when we look now. David had settled in a place called Ziklag, because when David looked, David not think about no throne again for go reign in Jerusalem. David not think about no kingdom again, because David had been running up and down like a vagabond for so long. So David find a place when he am Ziklag. So David just second. Am I talking to somebody? How many of you today are just settling? David just started to settle. And so when David went out one day to fight a battle, as David got back home, David saw the entire city of Ziklag burn up. I need to take this part simple. I need to take this part. Get my time with this part. When David went back with his men, the city was burned to the ground. Their wives were taken away. Their children were taken away. If anybody in here understands what despair is, when David looked, his wife was gone. House was gone. Probably David have a 2-bedroom. Intend to put him in an extra room. But now it burned down. So David, in himself, was extremely discouraged. Am I talking to the church? But to add hurt to injury, every single man that was with David, they weren't saying, "Brother David, we understand how you feel." The Bible said the men, David's men, when they thought about their wives and their children, take up stone. Am I talking to the church? Ready to kill David, because it is a part of our human tendency to do 3 things. One, when something bad happens, we fall into despair. There are many of us who, when God bless we, that's why sometimes some testimonies, it's difficult for me to listen to it. It's difficult for me to listen to you come today talking about how good God is, how much God provide. Next week you come saying that you're ready to give up. Then the other week you say, "God good, God great, because God opened my door for you." Then the next week you say, "Well, I'm ready to go back through the doors." It's difficult for me to listen to your testimony. One of our tendencies is when something bad happens, first thing is to find ourselves in despair. Start to worry. This won't work out. Oh God, this is just impossible. All I need to do now is worry. There are some folks, I believe, who get up daily and search through their menu to see which goodie to worry about today. Because if they don't worry, then I feel good. Am I talking to the church? So it is one of the first things that comes to us to be in despair. You lose your job. Your house burned down. Husband walk out. Wife walk out. The first thing to do is to be in despair. The next thing is to be or to get angry. Because after they were in despair, it moved from being discouraged to the point where them say, "No, sir. Right now, they get mad. It can't go so." Now, after you reach there, so you have despair, anger, the third thing that you do is you find somebody to blame. Am I talking to somebody? Because you're not going to blame yourself. Am I talking to somebody? Because it is our human tendency from the Garden of Eden to not take responsibility. It was Eve, said, the serpent. And Adam said, God, me did quite fine. I was here quite fine. And you say it was not good for me to be alone. So Adam said to God, said, God, are the woman, or you give me a blame yourself of your fault. So it is human tendency to put the blame on somebody else. But can somebody just come with me and look at David? Can somebody just imagine what David must have been going through at this time when David stood and all David saw was just smoke and fire. God, and when David looked in front of him, he saw no hope, and behind him was judgment because they were getting ready to kill him. God, I can just imagine in David's head, he must have been saying, praise God Almighty, why me? Because I was just a simple shepherd boy. Is there anybody in here who has ever been there where you said to yourself, say, God, me wish you never choose me? Is there anybody in here? All right, let me hold up my hand. God, is there anybody? Because David must have said, I was just taking care of my father's sheep. Not even my father didn't know me much. But God, you take me out of my father's house and then you put me in a Saul's house. I thought that I would have been in Saul's house and been there for a blessing. But the next thing me know, Saul get bad mind. I want to kill me. Why me, Lord? Am I talking to somebody? Oh God, I went out and slay the giant. I thought that everything would have been good. But the next thing me know, Saul take up a javelin, ready to throw right through me. Why me, Lord? Oh God, I was in my house quite fine and quite resting comfortable. But no, because Saul is trying to kill me, I have to be sleeping in a cave. Why me, Lord? Am I talking to somebody? I can just imagine David just standing and these thoughts are going through his mind. David said, I run from the cave. I didn't have nowhere else to go. Come on, brethren, wanted to kill me. So David had to run down to the Philistines. Remember now, you know, at the same one that went kill Goliath, you know, he went down into the land of the Philistines. Now David was an intelligent man, but because David no one dead, David had to go down into the land of the Philistines like a mad somebody. I spit upon himself and I do all sorts of things in order for them spare in life. David was down there and felt comfortable depending on the king of the Philistines. David could not look into it and say, why me, Lord? Am I talking to somebody? Let me tell you this, that in your despair, in your destruction, God is still in it. You might not see it, but God is still in it. Am I talking to somebody? I say, if God wants you, you can take the wings of the morning and go into the uttermost parts of the sea. But once there's a mark of God upon you, I don't care where you go, I don't care what you've done, but when God has a mark on you, he's gonna steer you in the direction that you must go. I heard the word said, the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. Even if you don't know, say, I'm gonna lead you, I still God, I bring you through. Am I talking to somebody? Let me bring something to your mind. You see, David did get comfortable down in Azil God. David did get comfortable not thinking about the throne. You see, God had David as a king But David just saw himself as a regular man. Am I talking to somebody? So you see, when David saw himself as just an ordinary man in God's sight, he was a king. So David said, I'm going to settle down in Zilgad with my wife and my pitney them. I'm going to enjoy life. Am I talking to the church? But when God have a purpose, so said God, say David, you get comfortable, man. So you know what happened? If me come and talk to you, you're not gonna move. So you know what I'm gonna go now. Me burn up everything. Yes, so am I talking to somebody? In order for God to move you, sometime God have to destroy something. Will keep you tied to your complacency. I said the fire that burned up the city of Ziglag, David saw it as his enemies, but little did he know it was God that allowed it to happen, because God saw David as more than who he saw himself. Am I talking to somebody? I say everybody was in despair, everybody was angry, but David just take care of himself. Somebody say take care of yourself. Yes man, say man, say take care of yourself. Yes man, the Christian then put it like this: sometimes I like to be all alone with my Lord. Am I talking to somebody? Every once in a while, you have to just take care of yourself. I said, David, take care of yourself. And when he looked, everybody did want to kill him. So the Bible said, David encouraged God himself. Am I talking to somebody? Turn to your neighbor and say, encourage yourself, man. Say encourage yourself, man. Say encourage yourself. Speak life over your dead situation. Speak victory over your situation. Speak healing over your one body. Am I talking to somebody? Learn to open up your one mouth and speak to yourself. Am I talking to somebody? Open your mouth and speak the word of God and say, we are troubled on every side, but still not distressed. We are perplexed, but still not in despair. And Paul said, I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. I heard somebody saying, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him. I say, I speak into myself when ministering on body to encourage me. I tell it myself, I can make it, I can take it, I can do it. If God is on my side, I don't need my brother or my sister, for I can do all. Somebody open their mouth. Somebody open their mouth. Somebody open their mouth. And start speak over yourself. Yes, man. That situation, you know it. Open your mouth, man. You never know, say, your power to declare over your life. I say, Ezekiel, open his mouth and prophesy to the dry bones. And God, the dry bones began to put on flesh. Open your mouth. Open up your mouth and encourage. I get you ready to close. I get you ready to close. But before I close, can I just touch Jeremiah? Just a little. I said Jeremiah was a prophet. Jeremiah was doing right. Jeremiah was living right. Jeremiah was doing everything that he should. Is there anybody in here who's doing right, walking right, but yet it seems you can't get a break? You're walking right, talking right, but it seems a peer problem. As Jeremiah prophesied what the Lord said he should prophesy, but then Jeremiah found himself in a prison. Can I talk to the church? The way how you write the script, you write the script for every page, you come out victorious. You write your page that every situation will come upon you, you're gonna fly through it and gain victory. That's how you write the script. So Jeremiah believed that when he prophesied what God told him, Jeremiah thought that all would have been alright. But Sister Brown, if you believe that in this walk with God, it's going to be a smooth sailing, then you've got another thing coming, mother. Because Jeremiah prophesied and found himself in a dungeon. Now understand this. If it was just a normal prison, it wouldn't be so bad. When you talk about dungeon, you're talking about the swarming. You're talking about where all the waste and everything go. Rats and all sorts of things is inside here. Filth, mess, all sorts of nastiness. Am I talking to somebody? But yet he was a man of God. But Jeremiah, God, he found himself the spirit of despair coming upon him, as it happens to many of you that are here, because there are many of you who knows that God has called you, but you look at your problems too much and you magnify your issues too much and forgetting the God who's able. And not only is he able, but he's willing to do exceeding abundantly. I said Jeremiah, he start look upon God as the trace of God. Is there anybody who has ever been there? I've been there before. When we look on certain things, we have one in my life, and when we look on system, I hear from God, I see no door I open. Lord God, me said God, me no want to hear from you again. Me said God, me no want to chat you again. Oh God, can I talk? Can I talk in the church? I said I've been there. But Jeremiah, he said, Lord, I will not speak in your name no more. I will not talk about you no more. Is there anyone who have said that? Me now go back in the local church. I treat God no more. Me not touch the Bible anymore. Me not speak in tongues anymore. Because I'm there. Look how me I get old and nothing now gone for me. Look how me neighbor them a drive big car. I'm still a tech taxi. Am I talking to somebody? Look how me neighbor them a build skyscraper. I'm still living in the one room. So you know what gone? Nothing now gone, so might as well me step out. But Jeremiah said, when he starts speak the negative, his word, that's why you have to read the word. Because when the time of despair come, when you can't sing the sweet song them, I give myself away. Oh God, when you can't sing, I gotta praise, I gotta praise. When you can't sing, Daniel's God surely will deliver. But when you have the word on the inside, you remember saying in his word, it said he will keep in perfect peace those whose mind is stayed upon him. When you got the word, you remember that the word said godliness with contentment is great gain. When you got the word, you remember the word said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things. Encourage yourself. You have to learn to encourage yourself. We're too easy to give up. too easy to throw in the towel. When things don't go the way we want it. Understand this. That the child of God's mind, it is supposed to be weird. It is supposed to be mad. God, can I talk to somebody? Let me explain it to you. The word of God is not understood by intelligence. Am I talking to somebody? So whether you got UE or UTEP, I ain't never graduate. It is not understood by one's intellectual capacity. Because if we reason it out with intelligence, we have to conclude that the Bible is just talking madness. And you'd be right. Hallelujah to God. You'd be right. Red Sea opening up and people walking through it. A madness that man. Man turning water into wine. A madness that man. Man walking on water. A madness that man. So me if you chat say, me not have a job, but God still a provider. A madness man. But there's also another word for madness. It's called faith. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for. And the evidence of things not seen. Somebody open the mouth and glorify them. Listen. Anything in life worth having don't come easy. You have got to be willing to press amidst the distress. Can I get an amen from my little boy there? Praise God. Can I just say something to you? I said this on Thursday night, but I want to encourage somebody who's walking with God or somebody who's a backslider in the house. Let me put something to you. I said it to the church on Thursday night. I came here and I could not manage to lift my hands. And anybody that is laughing, I command you not to laugh now in Jesus' name. You see, it's not a good thing to make Pentecostal people know your business, you know. Because when they know your business, they will come and laugh after you in a crowd. Praise God. So those who don't know, I wonder what going, those who know, I laugh. Pentecostal people, them. Praise God. So what happened is, I decided in my mind, because before I got married, and let me explain again, as I said on Thursday night, me stop going to the gym had nothing, right, to do with me getting married, right? Good. All right, so we established that. Bless God. God bless you. Praise God. So I got married. And you know, when I get married, life gets comfortable. Amen. Yes, yes. So, Jim, and so, I stall away from the gym. Ministry start. Life gets more difficult. So your friend said, I don't have any time to go to the gym. So I used to go to the gym, keep my body fit, because I'm from what we call a big bone set of people. We don't call it fat, we call it big bone. Praise God. So I remember one day I went up to my house to look for my sister. And what really hit me, I didn't even say it to you, but I'll tell the church now you're here. What really hit me was my sister said, "But Steve, you know, sister, daddy belly you have." Oh, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. So me as a young man here, say, "Me daddy belly me have." Praise God. So me say, "But no, sir, something, this can't work." So what happened is that all in my mind was I wanted to go back to the gym. But when I thought about the hard work, when I thought about the fact that because I had not been to the gym for so long, my body, my muscles were going to be in tear pain. I kept on withholding. I kept on putting it aside. My wife, once in a while, she would drop a little word, you know? Touch me and drop a little word. I said, "Look on your belly." You know, them look nice, little thing there. Yes. So look, look at your belly, I touch your steering. Praise God Almighty. Praise God. She said it in love. She said it in love. Praise God. So all those things, I took it as motivation because I knew what I had to do. But guess what? To get there was the problem. So I was in a position where I knew what I had to do. But to do it was a problem. I started to make excuses. All right, I want to get some more health products to drink and so on. And when I get more healthy, then I go to the gym. Excuses! So one day, I get some money. A missionary had some things to do. You know what I do? Just take the money, can't go to the gym, and pay down the membership. I didn't think about it. Didn't question it. I just paid down on it because me now gonna make your money go to waste. Talk to me or something. So I went to the gym and did one day. And when I did the one day, I felt good. That's like when I get baptized. Praise God. Felt like I was on cloud nine. I felt that, my God, I could just run through a troop and leap over a wall. I felt good. But when I got home, and I sat down, and the reality started to kick in, and the most of them thought, say, oi, why you not doing this a while ago? We don't feel too good. I felt some pain in my body. I couldn't lift my hand, I have to call my wife, I couldn't take off my shirt. Praise God. But then at the bed, my car move. I don't know if I drive the car. If somebody call me, I may drive. I have to come, so hold the steering, take out the phone, lean upon the car door. I said, so, hands can't move. I was in pain. All my wife couldn't do. I said, And let me tell you something she do too. She look at me and laugh. She laugh at me too. Praise God. But in my mind, I knew within myself that the pain comes with the process. So if I just continue to work through the pain, praise God. If I continue to press through the pain, praise God. So when everybody was laughing at me in the car because them see me can't stretch my hand, I know what I know in myself. Can I tell you something? There's coming a day when God is going to bring you before your enemies, them. And watch her, praise God. Watch her, watch her, watch her, watch her. Hallelujah. Somebody give God some glory. Stand on your feet everywhere. Encourage yourself, man. Encourage yourself, man. I said encourage yourself. Encourage yourself. Work through the pain. Press through the pain. Better is on before. You're hurting now, but your joy is coming. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy. Somebody say joy. Somebody say joy. Somebody say joy. Claim your joy, man. Claim your joy. Claim your joy. Claim your joy. But joy comes in the morning.
Bless the Lord, everybody. Bless the Lord, everybody. Can we give?
Say God, you turn a mess into a message. Now the messenger arrived. Committed to the journey, so me now go backslide. Looking through the spirit and the physical eyes. Ooh.